Okay, I'll call the meeting to order. Good evening, everyone. Welcome to this evening's public hearing. Welcome to council chambers. It's a public hearing into the bylaws that will be introduced to you in a moment by the city clerk. Council for the City of Coquitlam has given first reading to these bylaws and directed that this public hearing be held. Staff from the city's planning and development department will first present a summary of the proposed bylaw, after which the floor will be open to anyone in attendance that wishes to present his or her views on the proposed bylaw. I've got a list of people that are pre-registered to speak, and those are the only ones we're going to let. No, that's not true. Anyone will be allowed to speak once we go through this list. We'll ask everyone to limit themselves to 5 minutes. If you got more good stuff that we haven't heard yet, please get to the back of the line. We'll want to hear everybody at least once, and then we'll go through with anyone that still has some stuff. I stress to you all that this is a public hearing. It's an opportunity for anyone who has a view on the proposed bylaw to make that view known to council members. Council members are here with an open mind and are here to listen to your input. No one here has prejudged the outcome of these applications. However, it's not a question and answer period. It's not an opportunity to debate the merits of the proposed bylaws with either council members, with staff, or with those in the audience who may be opposed to your particular view. Although looking at this audience, I suspect you're all of one mind. I ask that everyone please restrict your comments to the proposed bylaw before us. Be as brief and concise as possible. So that's the 5 minute time limit. You can do it more than once, but please be brief and concise. And finally, we ask that everyone be respectful of each speaker and allow that speaker to complete his or her speaking points without interruption. And by interruption, we do mean no clapping, no booing, no cheering, no jeering. We find that in order to allow people to take that step and stand up at that podium, some people who've never done that before, they're more comfortable if the audience simply respectfully permits them to speak what they want to speak, and then you'll get your turn. As chair of this hearing, I've been asked by council to include any presentation that does not relate to the bylaw, that becomes abusive in any way, or becomes repetitive of views that that speaker has already made known to council members. Now, at the end of this public hearing, we cannot receive any further information on this item until council finally passes or not whatever changes we make. That's the rules established by court. So if you have something that, some written comments, for example, that you want to be part of the public record, please hand it to the clerk's desk here before we adjourn that item on the public, before we adjourn the public hearing. We have to receive everything before we adjourn, because after we adjourn, we can receive no further information. Immediately following the adjournment of the public hearing tonight, we'll convene a regular council meeting in order that council can give consideration to a number of items on the council agenda, as well as potentially the item on tonight's public hearing agenda. Although, well, we already heard, and it may well be that a council member may ask for some information or may ask that we defer the vote while he or she considers, and we may have more than one council member that does that. So we may not vote on this item tonight, but we might. I'll now call on Mr. Gilbert to introduce the bylaw on tonight's agenda, and planning and development staff to make the presentation.
Thank you, Your Worship. The item one on this evening's public hearing is an application for a text amendment to the City of Coquitlam Zoning Bylaw Number 3000 in order to revise liquor retailing regulations and permit liquor manufacturing within identified industrial, service, commercial, and commercial zones. This is bylaw number 4640, and Mr. Jarvie is here to introduce it.
Acting Supervisor of Development Planning. As Mr. Gilbert alluded to, tonight I'm here to present the public hearing for the liquor policy review. So just a little background on where we started. 2013, the province released what is referred to as the YAP report, included several recommendations for some changes to the liquor policies and rules in BC. So out of that, afterwards, staff were doing the industrial zone review, and questions came up in regards to liquor manufacturing and our liquor policies. So through that, we reported back to staff several times, and in September of this year, we started our public consultation for this. For our public consultation, we consulted with approximately 140 current liquor license holders, the general public, the Coquitlam detachment of the RCMP, interested in industry associations, and prospective business operators who had expressed interest in operating within the city. In particular, we were seeking the answers to five main questions. Do you support liquor manufacturing in Coquitlam? Do you support grocery stores selling alcohol through a store within a store model? Do you support grocery stores selling VCVQA wine on the shelf? Do you support keeping, reducing, or eliminating the existing separation distance requirements to schools, places of worship, public parks, and other liquor stores? And then finally, as well, we asked any other comments. So generally, the feedback from the general public was supportive of these changes. 94% respondents asked were in favor of supporting liquor manufacturing. 90% supported the sale of alcohol through in the grocery stores with the store within the store model. And 86% were in favor of allowing for the BCVQA wine sales on the shelf in a grocery store. In regards to the separation distances, generally people were favorable of eliminating or reducing those separation distances. And then from the current liquor license holders, the feedback was slightly different. The overwhelming was against supporting liquor manufacturing and against any form of sale of alcohol through the grocery store. In regards to the separation distances, largely in favor of keeping all the separation distances that we currently have. Staff's recommendations are that we permit liquor manufacturing with the accessory retail and outdoor seating areas in a number of our commercial, service commercial, industrial, and business enterprise zones. That we remove restrictions to allow for liquor stores to operate with a store within a store within a grocery store. And that we eliminate the separation distances from liquor stores to public parks, places of worship, and schools. And that we increase the separation distance between liquor stores from 300 meters to a kilometer. In regards to the sale of BCVQA wine on the shelf, staff's recommendation is that we continue to monitor this topic and report back to the council at a later date. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Jeremy. And our first speaker tonight is Gordon Cartwright. He's with Woody's Pub at 935 Brunette Avenue.
And the vote.
Mr. Cartwright.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. It's kind of an honor to be the first speaker tonight. And I want to start out by congratulating the Planning Department with the City of Coquitlam for their all their input and their very comprehensive liquor strategy policy. And saying that, we've worked with the Planning Department and we feel very well about that we can be a showpiece for manufacturing in our province by getting it right from the start, by looking at other jurisdictions, what they've done good and what they've done wrong. With 11 private and government liquor stores in Coquitlam and near our borders, we have 9 private liquor stores and 2 government liquor stores in Coquitlam. We feel that we can altogether promote the products of the craft breweries. So in other words, they have an extremely good outlet for their products. And also we have 110 other liquor outlets for promoting their product in restaurants, pubs, and everything else. So with the craft breweries and distilleries, it makes a very good outlet for the craft industry. So, because the rules are changing, i.e. tasting lounges, it's important that a public process be in order to for the licensing of the lounges and particular things. It's the same as any other retail manufacturer and application that we have to go through as licensees, and we expect, or we would suggest, that they go through the same thing. And right now there's been 37 or 38 policies of liquor policy implemented, but we've got 73 to go, so we're concerned about what the other things that we haven't seen come down the line yet. So that's where the public policy is extremely important that we go through with the liquor and alcohol. Moving on to liquor and wine in grocery stores, Coquitlam private liquor store owners, we met in all group, and we had a very extensive meeting with the planning department and with our consultant, Mr. Bert Hick, who will be speaking this evening. He's a former general manager of liquor licensing in the province. And Bert knows everything you want to know. So if you've got any questions, ask Bert. He's coming up. We had one major comment sheet to go into council, and then we had 50 comment forms from our meeting. We passed out the comment forms, and each person sent them in and to the planning department. So that was very well received. Our concerns under retail concerns that it's just the way that grocery stores have wines was implemented, like two in Surrey, one in Langley, and one in Tawassa. And these stores are all Save-On Foods, owned and operated by, and I'll refer to the back, BC billionaire Jimmy Patterson. The government has 21 licenses to sell. Apparently, we don't know who they're going to sell them to, but apparently it's suggested it'll be a few people, with the promise of 24 more wine licenses to the highest bidder. As stated in Michael Smith's column, and I put his column at the back of the information sheet I give you, which stipulates independents left high and dry as big groceries sell wine. And as I read from there, some critics are tasting sour grapes that it appears that the biggest store chains will be able to afford licenses. That was said by David Eby from the NDP liquor policy critic. So that far, it's a benefit to major grocery stores owned by the richest person in BC. That wasn't me saying that, was Michael Smith. It's terrifying for us stakeholders that we have invested our life savings in the business based on existing regulations, i.e. some of us have 20-year leases on commercial property. Some of us are got 10 years left. So we're extremely concerned about our business and what's going to happen in the future if the government regulations stay hold. So there are two interesting and significant analogies about this. We as private liquor stores, we cannot sell groceries in our liquor stores. So that's very interesting. And one thing that really interests me and the rest of people in this world, I think, is that the new Minister for Liquor Licensing and Control is now Minister under the leadership of Honourable Coralie Oakes. This is where it really gets interesting. Minister of Small Business, Red Tape Reduction, and Minister responsible for Liquor Distribution Branch. We found that very interesting. So we as small business people, who are thoroughly connected to our communities and council, we ask you to reject the greed of a few and protect your citizens and taxpayers. And if you read Michael Smith's comments in the back. So if you have any questions, or I'd be pleased to answer them.
Well, you've used up 42 extra seconds, Mr. Cartwright.
Is that for being first?
Yes, just because you're first. Everybody else, one moment. We've got Councillor Reed's got some tough questions for you.
How many jobs does your establishment provide in my city?
May I've got it written right here. We have, at Woody's, we have 52 employees. And so if you take that within 10 to 12 pubs in Coquitlam, so that's about 500 employees.
Does that include the stores and the pubs?
Sorry? That's the liquor store and the pub, yes.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. Yep.
But, you know, the other thing, too, with our business, and it's the community spirit we have with our fundraisers and everything we do in the community, and we're really proud of that. We just want to be able to keep it up. So thank you.
Okay. Councillor Hodge.
Just, again, for Mr. Cartwright.
Sorry. Oh. Run away.
Part of this discussion is going to be around the craft breweries. Do you sell any of the products from the microbreweries, or what do you sell? Are you just sticking to the traditional ones, or have you started to bring in some of these specialized beers?
Yeah, we have 17 in our pub.
Which would be, how many would be sort of what we call the new UBS specialty brews or craft brews?
Probably about 8.
Okay, good, thank you.
Yep, Councillor Zerillo.
For you too, Mr. Cartwright.
I'm going to stay up here all night, okay? Sorry about that.
Cartwright will tell you when you can leave.
It's like being in school, yeah.
Well, first of all, I do want to acknowledge that you and your business do offer a lot of support to the community and even youth in our community in sports and those sort of things. So I just want to acknowledge. I had a quick question for you about the standalone craft breweries. It's a bit of a trend right now, the standalone craft breweries. And I wanted to ask if you believe that they compete directly with pubs such as yours on Brunette. Do you feel that it's a direct competition to have these craft breweries?
No, I think we can be a big part of their success. Because if we're the retail outlet for their product, and if they manufacture in the product, as like I say, we have 110 licenses in Coquitlam to sell their product, and also in the liquor stores we have tastings as well. So the craft breweries come in and they do tastings. So as our customers come in, they're sampling that as well. And now with the new liquor laws, we're also allowed to do tastings in our pub. So it's an extremely good outlet for the craft breweries.
Great. Thank you very much.
Thank you. You can go home now?
Yeah.
Well, thanks, Richard.
Okay. Vanjie McCarthy at 842 Grover Avenue in Coquitlam.
Good evening, Your Worship and members of council. My name is Vanjie McCarthy. I live at 842 Grover Avenue for over 25 years. I'm here today to give my support for the proposed amendment of the City of Coquitlam zoning to allow brewery manufacturers with tasting rooms in Coquitlam. My family would like to open a craft brewery and tasting room and have done extensive research into the brewery business plan. We found that the BC Lower Mainland is mirroring trends that have been seen in places like Portland and even Ontario. The province of Ontario. The main question we asked ourselves was, is there a need for more breweries in the Lower Mainland? We compared Portland to the Lower Mainland. With a similar population to Vancouver Metro, Portland Metro has 91 breweries compared to Vancouver Metro, which has 53. The entire state of Oregon has over 280 breweries and climbing, compared to 115 in the province of BC. Thus, we feel there is still room for new breweries to grow, as it's become apparent that people are turning to interesting beer as an affordable luxury. Coquitlam is the third fastest growing municipality in the Lower Mainland and the fifth largest in the province. Our research found that it is both males and females between the ages of 25 and 55 that visit breweries the most. And with our fast growing municipality, younger people are settling in Coquitlam as it quickly develops into a bustling city center. Presently, there are no breweries in Coquitlam. Right now, there are 3 in Port Moody and soon to be 4, all being well supported by the residents of the Tri-Cities. I propose we bring back some of that revenue to Coquitlam. We have researched what is essential for a successful brewery. Beyond quality beer, it is mandatory to have a good location. A location that people can easily get to by foot, transit, and even by car on the way home from work to pick up an affordable growler to share at dinner with friends and family. A space like a favorite coffee shop, but serves interesting craft beer that people can meet for a visit and a relaxing drink. With Coquitlam's growth trending to higher density housing, a tap room close by is going to be appreciated by people who love craft beer, particularly young people starting out in condos and downsizing older people who desire a smaller home, both with limited space for home entertaining. These preferred locations need to be accessible in commercial areas. Thus, it is these accessible locations that we are here today to give our support to the recommended zoning changes for manufacturing beer and tasting rooms to be revisited by the City of Council. Thanks for listening to me tonight.
Thank you. We got one question so far. Councillor Hodge.
Yes, thank you. And thank you for the presentation. You mentioned location being key, and you talked about the need to be accessible. Now, I noticed the ones in Port Moody and in other cities, they tend to cluster together.
Mm-hmm.
And the experience seems to be you sample some here and then you go to the next one. How important is it to the business model to actually be clustered in the same area as opposed to being scattered throughout the city?
It is really important. It seems to be that people are wanting to do tastings, just like a wine tour. They like to try samples, take some home, whatever. And to have just one place, it becomes just one drinking establishment. They're not going to move on. Having several breweries side by side, it supports one another. People like to have variety. We find people are a little bit fickle. They often want to have more and more different choices. So having the side by side breweries, a little district, works really well.
Great, thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Second, Councillor Zerillo just added. Councillor Zerillo.
So that's interesting that you're speaking about that, because one of the recommendations today is to have a 1 kilometer distance between potential establishments. So as far as the sales go.
Yeah. I believe that was not for the breweries. Am I right? Yeah.
Mr. Jarvie.
Thank you, Your Worship. To clarify, the 1 kilometer separation distance would only be applicable to liquor retail stores and would not be subject to for the liquor manufacturing.
So can you just explain that a little bit? Because we're talking about ancillary sales like growlers that will leave the building. So we're not considering that liquor sales. Can you just clarify that?
Mr. Jarvie.
They are considered an accessory retail sale. However, the way we define liquor stores is where the primary function is to sell the alcoholic beverages for takeaway from the site, whereas the liquor manufacturing, the primary function is the manufacturing of beer. The accessory use is the retail sale.
Okay, so in all of these changes that are happening, do we anticipate that a brewery will be able to bring in someone else's alcohol and sell it to go out of that location? Even though it's not their primary business, do we anticipate that they will be able to cross-pollinate?
Councillor, Mr. Jarvie.
Thank you, Your Worship. As part of what the province's current legislation is that if you have a lounge endorsement, you're allowed to sell up to 20% of product that isn't manufactured on site for sale. That is a temporary measure right now. They're considering making it permanent, but at this time it's not a permanent regulation, but they would be able to sell 20% of the product not manufactured on site should they get a lounge endorsement.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Hodge.
Are there any restrictions as to the percentage of sales that have to be on site consumed there versus how much can be just sold and taken out from the door? The previous question, at what point does a brewery become actually a sales outlet? Is that defined in the legislation?
Question to staff, Mr. Jarvie.
To be honest, I'm not sure if there is a percentage of what has to be on-site consumption versus takeaway. but many of them are functioning with the takeaways being growlers to take home. Some of them do have some cans or bottles that they have within their coolers and take away from there. But predominantly it would be on-site consumption as well as some takeaway. And as far as I know, there's no percentage.
And on the takeaway, currently you said the 20% is a temporary right now under the lounge endorsement. I would assume that takeaway sales would be governed by the same, that you can sell 20% of somebody else's product for takeaway, just for tasting?
I'm assuming, I mean, it depends on how they have it available on site. I mean, if it was through a keg, they might be able to fill some growlers, or it may be glasses of wine for consumption on site. It could be distilled spirits. So it's not necessarily given that it would be for off site consumption. It may be on and it may be off site. Depends on what kind of packaging it is in.
Good. Thank you.
Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I didn't so much have questions for you. Next one is Braden Florio. Braden's at 206 11895 Laity Street in Maple Ridge.
Hi there. Good evening, Council. My name is Brandon Florio. I phoned in. Sometimes I stutter on the phone. Please forgive me. This is my first time speaking up on Council or on the web, I guess, too. I'm from Maple Ridge. I work at the BC Liquor Distribution Branch. I've spent a year and a half working in private stores as well. As it was already made clear, that the city of Coquitlam is already very well served by both public and private liquor stores. Excuse me, I'm a little nervous.
Doing well.
Thank you. So the BC Liquor Distribution Branch itself, we employ 3,800 members across the province. 1,700 of those are in the Lower Mainland, which does include our Vancouver Distribution Center, which only actually accounts for 700 of those members. So 1,000 people are working in our government source, and those are people working in our government source. That actually does not even include our truck drivers making deliveries. That does not work, can account for the BCLDB's pay, IT or administrative staff. Right. So, excuse me. So, with the Lower Mainland especially, and is already very well served. We contribute just over $1 million directly back into the province's economy. It would be a real shame to see that money go to the hands of a private retailer who's already very well served himself. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, our next speaker, Sherry Delaney from BC Government Service Employees Union.
Mayor and Council, thank you for letting me speak today. I want to speak as a citizen who lived for 10 years in Coquitlam. Now I live in Maple Ridge. As a mother and as a BCGEU member, we do have a few concerns. Personally, I think that we already have enough liquor outlets in the city, in most of the cities. I don't want to see more liquor outlets. I certainly don't want to see alcohol in grocery stores, unless it is the store within a store model. But even at that, I would prefer to see no liquor in grocery stores. I think it's only fair that the 1 kilometer rule be implemented. You know, we're talking about a lot of people's jobs. We're talking good living wage jobs, right, in the community. And if we lose these jobs, that's going to be very devastating to myself, to lots of our members. We do, as the BC government liquor distribution branch, we do support community efforts as well. We support Dry Grad every year. We support the Share a Bear program. And these are things that we do for our communities. I think that the health concerns, I think that there's huge implications for you know, addictions to be discussed. And if you go on the liquor policy review, you'll see all kinds of submissions from the addictions, BC Center for Addictions. They've done a great submission. Coastal Health has done a great submission. They don't support wine and alcohol in grocery stores. So I do want to thank city staff because I think they did a great job in their research. They've done a very good job. And we would support the recommendation of the 1 kilometer rule so that we don't have an overabundance of alcohol availability in the community. Okay. Thank you.
Yep. Councillor Wilson has a question for you, I believe.
Hi.
Hi.
Thanks for coming tonight. How do you feel about craft breweries in the format that they conventionally operate?
I don't mind craft breweries. I think it's a nice way for people to spend some leisure activity. And it's they're small businesses and they're in the community. And I think that's important.
So your main concern is with the liquor retail outlet?
Liquor retail, for sure. There is, if I can speak, I believe it was New Zealand when they implemented wine and beer sales in their grocery stores. A full 70% of all the 65 to 70% of all the wine sold in the country is now sold in grocery. So that can have a huge impact on all the liquor stores that are already operating, and certainly the government stores as well.
Thank you. Oh, Councillor O'Neill.
Yes, ma'am, I had a question as well, Ms. Delaney. Thank you. So just on the 1 kilometer rule that you said that you support, that we have that. Now, the provincial government has a 1 kilometer rule as well between jurisdictions. So even if we didn't have the 1 kilometer rule, the provincial government's rule still trumps ours, correct? Ours is...
That does not apply to grocery. It's my understanding that the 1 kilometer rule doesn't apply to wine and grocery stores, is that correct?
Mr. Jarvie, sure.
I believe ours wasn't going to either, or I'm not sure what was proposed. Mr. Jarvie.
Thank you, Your Worship. Right now, we're not recommending that wine on the shelf be subject to sale in the grocery stores. Therefore, it would not be subject to any 1 kilometer separation as it's not on the table this time.
Right. So if that gets enacted, it doesn't really matter one way or the other if we have the 1 kilometer rule. So in that respect, you're in favor of the way the provincial government employs its 1 kilometer rule.
Yeah, at the very minimum, yeah.
Now, the provincial government doesn't consider made in BC wines made with BC grapes as being sold in those called VQA wines, being sold in a VQA liquor store, VQA wine store as a liquor store. It considers it... That doesn't come under the 1 kilometer thing. Now, our regulations that are proposed tonight actually do consider, say that anybody that sells any store that sells any sort of liquor, even VQA wine, is a liquor store, but the BC government doesn't have that. Now, what's your opinion on that? Do you like the BC government's rule? Or
I prefer the 1 kilometer rule from all alcohol sales. I don't think that grocery stores, if they allow, in which case you're not recommending tonight wine and grocery, but if you do, I think it should be treated as alcohol, and I think it should be subject to all the same restrictions that the other liquor, any outlet that sells alcohol is restricted.
Now this gets pretty complicated. So we're not talking about the VQA wine in the liquor in the grocery store. Now we're talking about the standalone VQA store that the provincial government considers essentially a farm outlet. Now I don't know why our report here in the proposed bylaw hasn't aligned itself with the provincial government thinking on VQAs not being subjected to the 1 kilometer rule. You said you think VQA should be, and maybe since the subject is up there, I didn't see a staff rationale for why we're not aligning ourselves with the provincial regulation on standalone VQA stores. It's a really interesting subject, and I think it's an important one, as we're aligning ourselves with the 1 kilometer rule, but the provincial government defines liquor stores as anybody selling any alcoholic beverage except VQA wines, and we're including VQA wines in liquor stores. Maybe the staff can answer why we're doing that. I didn't see a rationale, and I didn't see anybody calling for that specifically.
I don't see anyone rushing to answer.
If they don't know, they can, yeah, they can admit that.
Sorry,
okay, we go, Mr. Jordan.
I had to be prompted.
Oh, there you go. Okay.
Thank you. Yes, the way we approached it was that, as you allude to, all liquor stores right now in Coquitlam are considered equal, whether they sell BC VQA wine or if they sell all alcoholic products. And part of our rationale is that we treat them all equally and have a 1 kilometer separation distance from any liquor store. So currently, we don't have a separate definition that has a BC VQA wine store.
But the motivation in this whole exercise is to try to better align and reflect perhaps some of our policies with the provincial government's policies, for better or for worse, trying to liberalize or perhaps liberalize in one way, trying to hold the line in another way. I just don't know the rationale why we said in this piece of legislation we're ruling out this alignment.
Mr. McIntyre.
Yes, thank you, Worship, and good evening, Mayor and Council. I guess it's how you cut the pie. As Chris said, on one hand, we're trying to obviously be consistent and follow the spirit of the provincial regulations. That's one of the basis for our recommendations. However, though, we also want to look at what we feel is appropriate in Coquitlam, and we didn't think at this point differentiating in the definition of liquor sales was necessary. We didn't want to overcomplicate matters either, so it was to provide that consistency across the board for liquor retailers. In this case here, it's quite correct, Councillor Niels noted that they aren't subject to the province's 1 kilometer separation, but we are suggesting that to be consistent throughout in Coquitlam, that we do apply that. That said, though, if a particular application came forward where there was merit to propose a location that was less than that 1 kilometer distance to another liquor store, that could be something that council could consider through the development variance permit process. So there's that ability to do that.
So it's sort of the way council has already decided on this issue in one specific case on Westwood Plateau, where we allowed in the same plaza a new liquor store to set up shop right across the parking lot from an existing VQA store. I think many of us were persuaded on that specific case that, yeah, it's kind of the same thinking as what the provincial government has on that. Yeah. And yet, so you came forward with something that said, no, we still aren't persuaded, but maybe on one-off basis in the future, we can still look at these for exemptions or special variances. Certainly we can, but I just want to know how you're thinking. I know how council thought before a few months ago. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? Councillor Hodge.
Staff, can you just give me a quick refresher just on the definitions? Store within a store. I know what the VQA on the shelf is, but just sort of walk down what we have now. You said all liquor stores in Coquitlam are considered equal, and we consider them to be just liquor stores?
Correct. Correct. At this time right now, we have one definition for liquor stores, and it goes for the retail sale of alcoholic beverages. Should council move on the recommendation tonight to allow for the store within a store models to occur within the grocery stores, these liquor stores would be able to embed themselves within the grocery store. There has to be some physical separation between the two. There is allowed movement in between the two stores, and you are required to purchase your alcohol within the store within a store. You can't you can't take the alcohol into the grocery store to purchase in there. The store within a store needs to be staffed with staff members who are trained in serving it right, and then they would then be able to sell it. They have to also be 19 years of age. The other option or the other model was the BCVQA wine on the shelf, and that would be within the general store itself, within an allotted area. There may be a designated till that has a cashier who's 19 years of old or of age, plus trained in serving it right, and then they would be allowed to take their alcohol products through the store and purchase it at that cashier.
So we're really going from one definition to two. A store within a store, which is really going to be treated the same as a liquor store, like the tradition, like the typical government liquor store. So those two will be, are they the same now, or are they're the ones that are separating out?
Well, there's no separate definition. It would still be considered a liquor store. Currently, right now, the way the zone is worded is we have the permitted uses of a grocery store, and we have a permitted use of a liquor store. We don't make a distinction in between the user of the liquor store, whether it be a public or a private liquor store. But we do have a restriction in the zone that does not allow for access from the liquor store to any other use within the same building. So they can be essentially sited right next to each other, and what we're saying is they can be sited in conjunction if we remove that restriction. They would still be subject to the 1 kilometer separation distance from any existing liquor store, though.
So in that respect, we would treat them as a liquor store.
That is correct.
And the store that's next to one of the pubs, they're just a private liquor store, so they would be subject to the same rule.
Yeah, they'd be subject to that 1 kilometer separation.
And so the only change, and we're not recommending it at this time, is the VQA wine on a shelf, which we're staff is not recommending at this time.
Correct.
Good, thank you.
Welcome.
Councillor Reed.
Just on that last point, VQA on the wine on a shelf in a grocery store. What happens then to the kids that are working in the grocery store that aren't 19, the cashiers and stuff? Do they have to have a dedicated place? I'd like that answer.
Okay, so if we were to allow it on the shelves, which we're not recommending, I guess. Would the staff be required to be over 19, or is there some other process, Mr. Jarvie?
From my understanding, in order for them to purchase or to sell the alcoholic beverages, they must be 19 years or older and be trained in serving it right. So the store must have a designated cashier or cashiers that would be able to do it, similar to tobacco sale.
Just confirming. Thank you.
Councillor Hodge.
Reading through the original report that we looked at back in February, just a month or so ago, I asked the question at that time, I guess it was probably first reading. It says that on page 2 of that document that the RCMP was supportive of the city amending its bylaws to reflect the provincial regulations, although they did note that there may be the possibility of increased shoplifting from grocery stores. Are referring to that point to the store within a store, or if we had gone to the VQA model? I'm just wondering what that reference is to. Is somebody here from the RCMP who could clarify this, please?
If you could introduce yourself and.
Good evening, Your Worship. Inspector Jeff Metcalf, the Operations Officer at Coquitlam Detachment. I think that we would be referring there to the liquor on the shelf model more so than the store within the store model in terms of concerns about shoplifting.
So you would treat the store within a store just like you would any other liquor store, and you would expect that would be the same
decision
from yours. And any concerns about the craft brewery model?
No.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Our next speaker is Kimberly McGregor. 13084 64A
Avenue.
Good evening, everyone, and thank you for allowing me to speak. And thank you for the good job that the staff did with their recommendations. My name's Kimberly McGregor. I also work for the LDB, Liquor Distribution Branch, and I am the component vice president for the liquor component of the BCGEU. But I'm standing here as a parent and a grandparent, and I urge you at the very least to implement that 1 kilometer rule if you don't see that alcohol, or if you agree that, that wine is okay to be sold in grocery stores, then I would, let's just say the 1 kilometer rule is, I would be satisfied with. It's bad enough that there are minors actually working in the grocery stores, and I'm glad, Councillor Reid, that you had spoke about it. It's bad enough they work in the grocery stores, they're under 19, and I don't know when it became okay for a minor to work where alcohol is being sold. I haven't heard that it's okay, so I am not quite clear on why it's okay in a grocery store as opposed to a liquor store. I think the availability of alcohol is more than accessible already in your communities, and I don't think you really need more outlets to available to the children. I am an alcoholic, and I was an alcoholic as a minor, and alcohol wasn't near as accessible as it is today. So that's my concern of putting wine on the grocery store shelves or store within a store model. It worries me, and I think it's time that we start fighting for our kids and our community and not worry about the almighty dollar, because our children and our communities are our future, and we won't have them if we're all drowning in alcohol. Thank you.
Okay.
Good. Am I sliding out? Thank you.
Thank you. When you speak about the 1 kilometer, I'd urge folks, there are two elements to the 1 kilometer. One is 1 kilometer from other sales points, and another one is 1 kilometer from other occupancies that we've listed there, including churches and such. So if you're specific to one or the other, please let us know which one it is you're in. Might be both. Okay. Our next speaker is Steve Ray at 813 Runnymede. Coquitlam, Mr. Ray.
Good evening, Your Worship, Council. I've been a resident of Coquitlam practically my whole life, and I'm a craft brewery customer. Currently, I have to buy from neighboring municipalities. I go to New Westminster, Burnaby, and Port Moody, and I'm here to support this proposal going forward because I'd like to be able to support local breweries within the city. I want to be able to walk, bike ride to a local craft brewery and not have to necessarily go across districts to get somewhere else. I encourage council to pass this and pass it quickly so that maybe by this summer we can be sampling some of the beverages in a local Coquitlam craft brewery. Thank you.
Thank you. Keith Stone from BCGEU.
Good evening, Your Majesty and Councillors. My name is Keith Stone. I also work in the warehouse. I like to take the...
I like this guy.
Thank You're Council right. for not having wine in grocery stores. The 1 kilometer rule should be enforced for both our union beliefs, both within wine in the grocery stores and with a store within a store model. No other liquor jurisdiction in the world gives exclusive rights sell wine in grocery stores. Ontario just recently announced, and you guys can Google it on the Toronto Star, there's a newspaper article out yesterday, that VQA wines in the Ontario version will be in their liquor stores. But in 3 years, all import wines will be allowed into their liquor stores. So there's been a lot of talk about a trade challenge here. And the California winery producers under NAFTA and Australia has already threatened to sue. So you think it's most of the small wineries like Church and State, I don't know if they're here tonight, they believe it's just for the big players. So the small wineries, as soon as all the cheap Argentine wines and South American wines and wines from all over the world come in, their products will be pushed off the shelf. So I've been around in the liquor business for a very long time. I've got 30 years warehousing experience. When I first started a long time ago, we had a similar thing. And it was called cold beer and wine stores. Originally, there was only 200 cold beer and wine stores. There are now over 700, probably around 750 cold beer and wine stores, but now they're full-blown liquor stores. There are enough places to buy liquor. So I'm glad council did not adopt putting liquor into grocery stores, because you risk the threat of those turning into full-blown liquor stores. We're already the second highest liquor jurisdiction in Canada that consumes alcohol out of all the provinces, only behind alcohol. Last year, we had a 15% spike in our sales through the government liquor stores. Overall, probably around 11%. We drink the second most per capita in Canada. The Center for Addictions and Disease, since we've liberalized our liquor laws, have attributed 31 extra deaths to alcohol. My son died. Coastal Health did a fantastic presentation. This is not counting cancer or anything else. I mean, these are deaths like from traumatic incidences. The more you liberalize alcohol, the more people drink. You might have some people say, oh, they grow up in Europe and they drink wine. Bogus. Europeans drink more alcohol than Canada. The more alcohol sale, all you have to do is Google that, alcohol per consumption per person. Anyone can find that on the phone. You just, Wikipedia will find that up. Europe drinks way more. Coastal Health, they went into things like fetal alcohol syndrome. You should look at what they did in Vancouver Council. They brought in a lot of health professionals. And they did a 45-minute, they even attributed the Stanley Cup riot to alcohol. Alcohol is a bad drug. It is probably causes more court costs, police costs, more damage to our society. Yes, our government makes $1.2 billion in alcohol, but it probably, you just go in front of a court, and the more liquor outlets, the more available you have, the more people are going to drink. It's scientifically proven. Some liquor stores in Alberta are open 24 hours a day. So if you want to risk losing your grocery stores, turning them into more liquor stores, under the YAP report, they want to put craft beer in there too. Well, once you get craft beer in there, and once you get the liquor in there, they're almost kind of like an old cold beer and wine store. It's kind of like BC liquor and craft beer. And all of a sudden, the hard players are all saying, well, we got to get our hard alcohol in here. And every single grocery store in the province will be slash a liquor store. Then the small 7-Elevens will be claiming, we want liquor. Why don't we just sell liquor on the streets? So I want to give council credit for not going ahead of getting alcohol in liquor in grocery stores, wine in grocery stores. I think that is very good, because even the experts under the Free Trade Act, and you might want to have your own lawyers look at it, it's probably going to take 5 years or 10 years to even get a herd out of free trade, but eventually the Australians and the whoever else, the people from California producers, will probably win, and they'll get their wine in there, and that's already the submissions I've heard. And finally, as a parent that lost a son to alcohol, I urge you not to put alcohol in grocery stores. You don't want to have a mother walking down the aisle and saying, do I want broccoli or do I want wine? Or a dad walking down there saying, do I want beer or am I going to buy meat? And that's people's choices. You can keep the kids out of liquor stores. There's a lot of myths. Jim Pattison's group will come up here, and they're going to say some of their guys make a living wage. That's 40 hours a week. Most of them start off at $11 an hour. They never get a 40-hour week. They're all permanent part-time their whole life. There's a lot of myths that they display, and so I want you to be careful. You even go to Urban Fair. They say, why don't we have BC wine in our stores. Well, go down to Urban Fair down there right now. Why don't they have BC Wine only in their restaurant? They just want to make a profit. They're playing the long game. They want to make money. They want to turn into full-fledged liquor store because it's $1 billion, and it's all about greed. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilor Cirillo.
Yeah, I just want to thank Mr. McKee for his comments. I think it is difficult at the municipal level to take into account some.
So it's Mr. Stone.
Mr. Stone,
McKee,
sorry.
The next one.
Made notes on Dorothy. It's sometimes difficult at the municipal level to think about the social impact of the decisions that we make, and I thank you for your heartfelt comments today.
Any questions?
No.
Okay. Our next speaker is Mike McKee. Mr. McKee is at 1410 Parkway Boulevard.
Good evening, everyone. I wish to thank your worship and council for letting me speak this evening. First of all, I wanted to thank city staff for their outstanding report. Tonight, I'm going to speak specifically about the items in the report related to liquor stores. I thought the report was comprehensive, and I feel it's going to become a template used by municipalities across the province. Sure, some of you remember me as I stood before you all about 8 months ago as part of a vigorous approval process for the new store my family and I put into the Westwood Village Shopping Center. I felt this process was balanced, the interests of business, public safety, and public convenience. And I'm glad that staff and council will continue to ensure that any new retail liquor outlets will face the same necessary public scrutiny as all the other liquor retail outlets here tonight have to ensure that any new liquor store works for everyone in the community. Obviously, we had an issue, or not an issue, but we were dealing with a VQA store across the parking lot from ourselves, a standalone VQA store. And you know, liquor on grocery store shelves is a seismic shift from a simple standalone VQA liquor store or VQA wine store. Anyone have any questions?
Councilor Wilson does. Right over here.
Thanks for coming tonight. How do you feel about craft breweries next to or in close proximity to existing pubs?
We love craft breweries, so we have no issues with them being next to our pubs. And in fact, we're strong supporters of them in our liquor stores.
And so it's not only to be able to offer their beer in your pub, but to have an actual craft brewery and a tasting room in close proximity to the pub. You're not opposed to that as well?
No. We feel that the rules in place are sufficient for protections there.
Thanks. Okay.
Thank you very much. Carolyn McCarthy. Got an address that I recognize. Oh, okay, it's because Fanchi. Same address. Okay. You're allowed to have a completely independent thought.
Good evening, Your Worship and City Councilors. I'm here today to give my support to the amendment of the City of Coquitlam zoning bylaw, specifically when it comes to craft breweries and distilleries, the less contentious of the topics tonight, it seems. I want to start by acknowledging some of the obvious concerns some people have had about craft breweries, and that's the potential for drinking and driving. I want to say that this is something that can be said for any regular bars, pubs, liquor stores, or restaurants in our communities. The solution for this, as recommended by the city staff, is to allow craft breweries to manufacture in commercial areas on major public transportation routes and close to residential areas. For example, in Vancouver, many of the craft breweries there don't even have parking areas simply because they are within walking distance of major hubs as well as on major transportation routes. And from my experience, I've never been in a brewery where people have drank to mass consumption and then gotten in their car to drive home. It's just a much different culture. When you visit a local brewery, there is a sense of community where people come to try the latest beers and meet the people responsible for making them. Similar to the trend of buying local produce at a farmer's market, breweries offer consumers the chance to buy local beer instead of the mass-produced, often American-made options, thus supporting local business owners. Craft breweries are good for the local economy. They create jobs and they promote tourism. Breweries are popping up all over the province and in droves right next door in Port Moody, with 3 and 1 more on the way. More and more businesses are being created specifically to cater to the brewery business. Brewery tour companies are expanding and taking advantage of the reputation BC has quickly cultivated. A prime example of this catering to craft beer culture can be seen at the upcoming Coquitlam Craft Beer Festival on March 11th and 12th. One day after the event was created on Facebook, more than 1,500 people were interested and more than 300 were confirmed attending. For this reason, the organizers have now added a second day of an event that was supposed to be only on one day. Today, 1 month out, it's completely sold out. So there's no doubt that Coquitlam residents are fans of craft beer. And this year, there are no Coquitlam breweries at the Coquitlam Craft Beer Festival. So this is obviously a problem, and it would be great to see that changed for next year. So I encourage Coquitlam to join the rest of the province in the craft beer revolution. Thank you for listening to me.
Thank you for not saying how you can get tickets, because I'd have had to rule you out of order. Any questions? No. Thank you. Our next speaker is Bert Hick, someone who actually was referred to earlier.
Your Worship, members of council, thank you very much for having this hearing tonight. And at the outset, I want to say thank you to your staff for a wonderful consultation process with respect to the liquor policy review. It was very thorough, lots of consultation and dialogue, and I think it's a good report. I'm going to make my comments, because they have to be brief, relative to two areas. First of all, with respect to the issue of craft breweries and tasting lounges, my recommendation to you is to look upon the lounges at craft breweries as though they're like a pub. And so from a land use perspective, I'd regulate them like you would a pub. Breweries are great. I think the craft beer industry is great. But the provincial government now allows them to have tasting lounges, which have entertainment, TV monitors, food, and also can sell product from other manufacturers in their establishment. So they're essentially a pub. So I would encourage you to look upon them from a land use perspective similar to that. My background in terms of this whole thing was, I used to be general manager of the Liquor Control Licensing Branch back in the 80s, when we too did a liquor policy review report, chaired by a gentleman by the name of John Jantz. Well, there's a report. And when John Yap, seems to be, if you're going to do a policy review, you have to have the name John. But when John Yap did his policy review, I found a lot of what we did in 1987 was relevant to what John did just a couple years ago. With respect to issues before you, a liquor store is a liquor store is a liquor store. Alcohol is alcohol is alcohol. And I would encourage you to have the 1 kilometer radius proposal apply to all retailing of liquor. That would include liquor and grocery stores, whether it be the store within a store, store on a wine on a grocery store shelf, or between licensee retail liquor stores. The reality is these stores are going to evolve in terms of product selection over time. The craft beer industry is lobbying the provincial government to have craft beer in grocery stores. You're going to hear from a lawyer in a few minutes, Mark Hicken, who's going to talk to you about the trade issue, which was also referred to earlier. There are trade challenges coming, because what the government has done by putting BC wine and taking them from cute, cozy, quiet, quaint little VQA stores in tourist areas like Nelson, Kelowna, Penticton, Victoria, and moving into grocery stores is a whole different retail animal than what was permitted by the government back in the 90s when they created the VQA store license. So I would look upon them as going to be eventually full liquor stores with full potential. With respect to the retailing of liquor in the province of British Columbia, I put up on the screen recommendation 19 from John Yap's report regarding liquor retailing. He says the province should develop and implement a retail model that meets consumer demands for more convenience by putting the sale of liquor in grocery stores. Government should continue to restrict the total number of retail outlets and require the separation of grocery products and liquor. This reflects the views of health and safety advocates and acknowledges the safety benefits of restricting minors' access to alcohol. So what he is proposing is the store within a store model. Something like you've kind of got going on in Coquitlam with respect to the fact that Rhino's liquor store is moving across to where the new Safeway store is going to be, and they'll have a liquor store beside the grocery store, where you go here and you go buy your liquor products, and then you go here to buy your grocery products. John Yap did not propose a store with a wine on the grocery store shelf. That came after his report came down. He was not proposing that you have BC wine or other products on the grocery store shelf next to the pickles. He felt that because of the safety concerns, it should be a store within a store. And you stop and think about it. As human beings, there's only two places we really have to go to buy anything. The first one's a clothing store, particularly if you live in Ontario right now. The second one is a food store. We all have to eat. Doesn't matter if you're a youth, doesn't matter if you're a former convict, if you're a recovering alcoholic, an alcoholic, or whatever. We all have to go buy groceries. And if your number one demon is right there in front of you in a grocery store, it makes a difference. When we did the liquor policy review in 1987, we were really shocked about the social impact of alcohol in our province. Reference was made here earlier about Dr. Tim Stockwell's Center for Addiction Research and his findings about access to alcohol. The more you make alcohol available and more access people have to it, the higher social costs are going to be. The police will have to deal with it. Social workers are going to have to deal with it. Families are going to have to deal with it. So my recommendation is keep wine out of grocery stores, keep liquor out of grocery stores, go with the store beside a store or store within a store model. The grocery industry can be in the liquor business. Costco could be in the liquor business. You just have to go and buy a liquor store. And if the rules work in the province, the 1 kilometer, put it beside a Costco store and have it as a separate retail entity where you can control access, control environment. You have no need to be in a liquor store unless you're over 19 years of age, really. So that is my presentation. I think what's happened here is the government ought to be, there's an old saying, don't start vast plans with half-assed ideas. And I think what the government did here, they thought it'd be neat to put BC wine on the grocery store shelves, but they didn't think it through all the consequences of it, what it could evolve into. Thank you.
Okay, I have one question for you, if I could. So the province has proposed some regulations. To what extent is this a local issue or a provincial issue? And I think you know where I'm coming from here. Where does this then get decided in 162 municipalities across the province?
Well, often, as you've, I find that the province does makes a change in policy that often the municipalities have to end up worrying about regulating and deal with. And in the case of municipalities, liquor's one of the major ones. And back in 1987, when Carol Taylor was the councillor responsible for the city of Vancouver on liquor matters, we started a process to turn more decision-making over to the municipalities because she came to me and said, look, we in Victoria were creating problems that they had to deal with at the city level, and you're going to see that here all the time. You have to deal with it through your police budgets, social costs, and everything else. So I don't know if I answered your question or not totally, but I do see a downward.
I was hoping you were going to say, Mayor Stewart, you were exactly right, but... It's just one of our challenges is we keep getting dumped more responsibility on by the province and without the tools. I've got two people with actual, I think, questions for you, Councillor O'Neill and Councillor Hodge. Councillor O'Neill.
Thank you very much. On the four specific aspects of the proposed bylaw, and I just want to get your opinion on each of the four as succinctly as you can. One is to maintain or to have an increased separation between liquor stores. Currently, we call for 300 meters. We want to increase to 1 kilometer between any liquor store. You agree with that?
Yes.
Okay. Second one, no separation. Currently, it's between liquor stores, parks, schools, and churches. Currently, that's 300 meters, and we're saying no. We don't need that. It's redundant, not needed. What do you think?
I agree with that.
Okay. The third one is allow a store within a store, but not allow wine or anything, any other liquor on the actual shelves. So I think you said you do agree with store within a store model.
Correct.
Right, okay. So the final one is the creation of amending our manufacturing and commercial zones to allow brew pubs and distilleries. Now, what is your specific thought on that?
On that one, I think that if someone wants to establish a brewery, great. But if they go to apply for a brewery lounge or a tasting room, then they should have to go through the same process as I would have to do if I was standing here trying to get approval for a neighborhood pub.
How about off sales?
Well, off sales goes with a brewery, you know.
So you're allowed. So you would say
yes.
You can have a brew pub where they brew and they have retail sales there. Yeah. Your concern
of their
is
own product.
Of their own product. Your concern is the lounge. Yeah. What could happen in a lounge in there? Yeah. How about tasting?
I think you can go in and have a small tasting. Okay. I think that's fine. But when you can go in and just sit there and have a full operating like bar, have full glasses of beer, you're drinking other people's beer products, they've got TV monitors, it's a bar.
Okay. Got the clarification. Now I want to just get some clarification from staff then on the process that would allow a full-type lounge environment in a brew pub. Is there any differentiation from our point of view? Or does there have to be special liquor board clearance, or how does that work? And you're probably going to have to stay there, Mr. Hick, because I know Mr. Hodge, Councillor Hodge has a question. So that's two different things that we're looking at here. Certainly the one thing we're hearing from many, many members of the public is that that the brew pub's great idea, it's tasting, let's be able to bring a growler home and things like that. But the other question is when that brew pub becomes a de facto lounge. Now, can that happen just like that if we change the bylaw this way, or what?
Sorry, sure. If I could just clarify before we get into that, there's a clear distinction in the type of licensing for a brew pub. A brew pub is a liquor primary establishment that also has a liquor manufacturing license. They can operate independently.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, I was getting mixed up. I meant a craft brewery. Go back and edit all those comments. I didn't mean to mix it up with the brew pub.
My assumption was you were talking about the liquor manufacturing.
I was talking about the craft brewery. I'm sorry. Yes.
Correct. I just wanted to make sure.
Thank you very much.
About the same thing. Yes.
Yeah, craft brewery.
Yeah, so the recommendation from staff tonight is that we allow liquor manufacturing as a permitted use within the number of zones. As part of getting that liquor manufacturing license from the province, you are entitled to have a tasting room associated with that. Should you wish to get a lounge endorsement, there is a separate endorsement process that needs to be applied for through the province. And because Coquitlam has opted into the referral process, our council would receive a referral requesting our feedback, and then we would make a recommendation to the province.
Good, that's an important distinction then. So it wouldn't be an automatic thing. And in that sense, it's sort of a level playing field. If they did want to become a full lounge, it would have to come back to the provincial government and to the local government. So the bylaw that's before us now would just simply create that brew pub with a tasting and some off sales. Anything beyond that would be something different. So the brew pub with off sales and a little tasting, you're in agreement with as well.
But with a brewery, a craft brewery.
I'm sorry, I'm getting mixed up again. Yeah. Craft brewery. So
I have a craft brewery, I craft support brewery. The process. It would have to go through a review brewery. Process.
Sorry. I am awfully sorry about confusing people even more on a very confusing subject, and obviously had to go spinning. So essentially in all four points of our bylaw proposed changes, you're in agreement with.
Generally, yes, but I think the wine on grocery store shelves is an important one to watch.
To watch, but we're not proposing to allow that. And again, craft brewery, not brew pub. Thank you very much. Okay, Mr. Hodge. Okay.
Thank you for help clarifying everything that we had. He used to be a journalist. No offense to the journalists. Councillor
Hodge.
Councillor Hodge.
Okay, I'm going to try and stick to the script here. Craft brewery. Could we go through just a little bit about the difference between a craft brewery and when they get the lounge and they can apply for a lounge license? What's included? Primarily, I'm curious in can they have a TV as a craft brewery, or do they have to have a lounge license to have a TV?
Mr. Jerk.
Again, to be honest, I'm not aware of whether or not there's a restriction on whether or not they have a TV. In my experience, I haven't been in any breweries that had any TVs. It's not typically associated with those types of uses. Perhaps the speaker may have an answer to that question. He's very knowledgeable on the liquor policy.
There's some in Vancouver that have TVs.
But can they have them? Do they have to have the lounge license in order to
get the lounge endorsement, and they're set up to operate like a pub. I mean, the tasting room is really set up for people who want to go in. And we got some folks here from the industry, so they talk too. But you go in, used to be a day when you went into a brewery and you took a brewery tour, and then you got the little samples, and you could sample just like when you go to the Okanagan for a wine tour, you get the little samples. And if you like the product, you can buy some cases of it or bottles of it and take it home. But now the government has taken it to the next level. We can have essentially a bar, a pub at the site with food service, carry product from other establishments and entertainment.
Right. And so to sell 20% somebody else's product, that goes with the lounge upgrade.
That's okay. Right.
So that's, I'm just trying to draw the distinction, because you said that one of the concerns is that these could start to operate like pubs, in which case, from a land use standpoint, we should treat them as a pub.
Yeah.
But there's a very big distinction, I guess, between the true brewery with the tasting lounge and the what is actually a mini pub,
no question.
Is what you're saying.
Yeah. No question. It's a true brewery with just a tasting room, the small little samples, that's pretty benign.
Right.
The other part starts to operate like a pub.
And what about seating? I don't go to many pubs, but I've been to a couple. They've got picnic tables out in back. Is that when they move to the lounge, or is that part of the tasting?
It's part of the lounge.
Mr. Jarvie's trying to reassert his knowledge about alcohol.
I'm trying to take the mic back from Mr. Hick. The outdoor seating areas are, again, that's a separate endorsement. If you want to get a picnic endorsement, again, that's another add-on that you need to go through the province for. And as far as their licensing goes, they need to set out areas. And one area is a tour. It can be a tour area, their seating area, their cashier area. And the occupant load, the number of seats, would be determined through the building code and fire code in terms of number of people permitted, as well as the number of washrooms.
And washrooms is by building code?
Correct.
Now, the picnic add-on, is that could be an add-on to the craft brewery, is one sort of a one-step, you know, is it sort of a step up? I'm just wondering, you know, is that can be added to a lounge license, and it can be added to a craft brewery license, the picnic option?
The liquor manufacturing is the primary license, and then the add-ons would be the lounge endorsement as well as a picnic endorsement. I'm not sure if they're necessarily mutually attached or if they can be independent, but they are both separate add-on pieces.
Both one or the other or both?
Or all three.
Yeah, all three.
Yeah.
The add-on, okay. And are minors allowed into craft breweries, into the taste rooms? Can somebody under 19 go in with a parent?
Yes, that is correct.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Zerillo.
So just adding on to that before I forget. So if it's a craft brewery, sorry, Mr. Hick, because it's going to be questions two through to staff. If it's a craft brewery that gets the lounge endorsement, then no longer can the kids be brought in?
Mr. Jarvie.
The children are still allowed within the liquor manufacturer that has a lounge endorsement. They're also allowed in liquor primary establishments. One of the 73 recommendations was to allow for families into liquor primaries up until certain hours. And with the liquor manufacturers, they're permitted in there as well.
Okay, thank you. So I had a couple of questions, and one of them relates back to bullet 5 of our recommendations for the bylaw amendment, and it's number 2, permit outdoor seating areas for liquor manufacturers consistent with other liquor and food primary businesses. So what I just heard right now was a lounge endorsement is a must before they can have outdoor seating, but we're saying in our bylaw that even if you're a liquor manufacturer, you can have outdoor seating. So I'm just, can you just clarify that for me, please?
Certainly. Thank you, Your Worship. Right now, the way our zoning is worded is that all uses must be enclosed within a building unless otherwise explicitly permitted. So an outdoor seating area isn't a given within the zoning. So in order to allow for the accessory outdoor seating areas, we have to also allow for it as a permitted use. So attach it to this to the zone that way.
So I'm trying to understand if we're, because I actually, it's this is a wonderful discussion, because basically the anecdotal stuff I've been hearing out in the community is people want to go, like they're going down to the Port Moody Brew craft brewery area, and they want to sit there for the evening, and they want to have entertainment, and they want to grab a sandwich, and really what we're talking about here in this bylaw discussion today is a very limited manufacturing where there's a small taste. So I'm just wondering how we why we need outdoor seating permits if we don't have the liquor or the lounge endorsement.
Mr. McIntyre.
Yes, thanks, Your Worship. I think we're making progress here. I think there's some clarity. But just to reaffirm on that, what we're recommending and what I hear the speaker speaking in affirmation to is for a craft brewery, that's for a facility that manufactures beer, there's additional activities that can take place there. And so on one hand, what we're recommending in this zoning bylaw amendment package is to only allow the processing, the manufacture of beer in a number of zones, but also to allow for the on-site consumption and sale. Now, some of that may trigger additional liquor licensing requirements to the province to have the lounge endorsement, i.e. to sort of act sort of like a liquor primary so people can come in. It's not just a small tasting area. But to have that lounge endorsement so you can come in and sample the product plus up to 20% other product, or to go outside in an outdoor seating area.
To be clear, when you said sample, you meant consume the product.
Yeah. Yes, thank you. On site. That too would trigger an additional liquor licensing requirement. Those liquor licensing requirements, what we're recommending would be referred to the City of Coquitlam, because we've chosen to opt in. Council has chosen in the past to opt in on liquor licensing referrals. And we have a policy that we updated not too long ago to give some guidance and some reference to that. And so in those instances, if council supports the bylaw package to allow for the craft brewery, the manufacturer of beer on site, what we're also recommending is to allow for the lounge endorsement and for an outdoor seating area. That would then trigger liquor license referrals back to council at the time that such a business wanted to get established. So there is that fallback referral to council. So if council supports this package, we will have to come back in very short order with an update to our liquor license referral policy to allow for that.
So that concerns me, because we have a listing here, M1, M2, B1, C2, C4, C5, C7, CS1, CS2, and CD1, all allowing to have breweries with the ability to, and I know it'll come back to council, but if we're going to do these in communities and we're going to let them be outside, I'm not feeling good about it at this point. So one other question before I'm done. Do the Port Moody craft breweries have lounge endorsements, all 3 of them that are down there? Because it seems to me you can spend the night down there.
Mr. Jarvie.
Thank you, Your Worship. Yes, the 3 that are currently open do have lounge endorsements, and Port Moody has opted out of the referral process.
So I just find it interesting, because I think most of the perception out on the street is that if council approved this, that we're automatically at the point where they have lounge, not that they officially have lounge endorsements, but that the atmosphere is exactly what they're experiencing in other cities. So anyway, it's very interesting discussion, and I thank you for the information. Thank you.
Councillor Reed.
Well, Mr. Hicks is standing there, so I'm going to ask him a question. There's a vast difference between a brew pub and a craft brewery, correct?
Correct.
So with a craft brewery, which is the one that I think we're mainly concerned about getting, I want to ask about this picnic area. Is that what they're calling it? A picnic area. So if you own a pub, you have to apply for a certain number of seats on your patio. And with those seats on a patio, you have to have a certain number of parking spaces. Is that correct?
Correct.
So with a craft brewery, I have heard that they just put tables in the parking lot or do whatever they have to do. Can you confirm that there is any regulation?
Yeah, the brew pub, where you have a...
Not a pub, and a craft brewery.
You're right. With a patio, you have to comply. With a brewery, I'm not sure what your requirements here are.
Okay, so it's not regulated, so our staff would know that, wouldn't you?
Mr. Jarvie, please don't refer this to Mr. Hicks.
Okay, well, I have nothing to say then. No, thanks. The right now, we don't...
Craft brewery is all I'm interested in.
Okay, and more specifically was, are they going to, if they were to get a picnic endorsement, are they confined to a certain area? Is that the question?
Confined to a certain area, confined to a number of seats, and confined to appropriate parking, just as the pubs are.
Yeah, just as pubs in the city of Coquitlam, they're regulated by the size of their indoor square footage, not on additional outdoor area. It's directly related to the size of the building or the size of the unit that they occupy.
They still have to have parking requirements the same as a pub would.
In certain zones, it would be the same. In different zones, they may have some different parking regulations, but they would be applied similarly. As far as the number of seats in a picnic area, again, it would be tied to the building occupant load and not restricted through the provincial government regulations.
So do we have... Can the province override us on a liquor application if they want to do their regulations and yet we have tighter regulations? Would they abide by ours? That's one for Mr. Hicks, maybe.
I don't think the province would override you.
Yeah. If I could, Your Worship, I realize it gets a little complicated when you've got provincial regulation and municipal bylaws and also policy. But I think one of the things that a liquor operator has to demonstrate when they apply for a license to LCLB is that they are in compliance with local government bylaws in that jurisdiction. So there's that piece of it. Then secondly, as I mentioned before, there's the license application referral. And that's where LCLB refers it to the city, and it comes forward to council. Council's dealt with these on occasion. And I think our track record's pretty good with that. I think what I mean is where a referral's been made to the city and city council has consulted, received information, and reached a position on that, which is communicated back to the province, they by and large will respect that as you know, elected officials in that jurisdiction, if that's their position, we'll work that into our liquor licensing decision.
Well, we worked for many years to have liquor stores in appropriate places and pubs in appropriate places, and the people that are in our community now have had to go through all the hoops that we've put up in order to have their businesses. And it's very important to me that we do not I want to see the craft breweries. I think they're kind of fun and they're trendy and it's something new. But I am really, really concerned with the amount of zones that we have in this bylaw. And I need to either eliminate or change or do something with some of these zones. Otherwise, you could have a brew pub anywhere. And you know, I might just have to apply for one in my living room or something. But you know, it's just too open. So I'm having difficulty with that. Mr. Hicks, thank you. Thank you very much.
I don't know what to say about the living room thing. Yes. We'll be moving our council meetings. Councillor Hodge.
Okay, thank you.
One moment. Thank you.
Okay, I understand. So we clarified the picnic. If they get the picnic add-on, that opens it up. It is by area. There's no seat requirement. There's no 20 seats, 30 seats. It's basically whatever they can configure. I just wanted to make sure I've got that because I thought I heard it both ways. In a traditional pub, the licensing is by how many seats there are in a patio, but in a craft brewery, there is restriction on how many seats they can have, or is it just by how much space there is?
Yes, that's correct. It's by how much space there is, so the occupant load of the unit would dictate the number of seats that they could have.
But not by regulation, just by physically how much room they have. Or is there regulation that dictates the number of seats?
From what I understand, it's all defaulted to what the occupant load is.
Which is a building code thing. Even on outdoor, that still applies.
Correct. And from the provincial standpoint, they don't restrict the number of seats on a patio area. Or the picnic area, sorry.
Right. So from a liquor licensing standpoint, there's no seating limits as there is in a pub, though. Is that correct? Are pubs regulated by seats anymore, or is it by occupancy load?
To be honest, I'm not very familiar with the pub process.
Yeah, no, just occupancy load. There used to be a day when a pub was 65 seats, right, or 95 seats, but now
so
it's
that's,
just occupancy
that's
load.
Gone. Okay, good, thank you, and it's gone for both, okay.
Well, there was changes about a decade ago that made it only based on square footage, the building code occupancy.
Okay.
And sorry, Councillor Hodge, just to confirm on that, they often check with our staff to confirm occupancy code. We sign off on that.
Thank you, Mr. Gilbert.
Just curious on this, and you're probably not the person to ask on this one, but maybe you can give me some insight into this. The craft breweries that we normally see, or the ones that I traditionally see, they seem that they probably have lounges because they have the large glasses, and there's a lot of people, and they're, you know, different products. In the sort of the basic craft brewery manufacturing type model, where they have a tasting room, it's just a very small glass, correct? Is that the norm, or do more of them actually go to the lounge? I would think that for the experience, they would want to go to the lounge license, or are the ones just with straight tasting in small glasses, are they just as popular, or what sort of is the industry norm?
Well, ideally, you want to have a lounge because that's where you can sell your product and sell other people, and you can make more of an event. The tasting size is very small. It's regulated. And it's just a small sample to find out if you like the product or not.
Right. So okay. So that brings me to a follow-up question to the question that Councillor Reed was asking, and that's on the zoning. Because from a manufacturing standpoint, it makes sense to have this wide range of areas and zones. But if, in fact, the better business model is to operate with a lounge, then they operate closer to what a pub would be. And that becomes problematic, I think, from a land use, because not all these areas identified on the map, I don't believe that they are all conducive to having a lounge type or something that's closer to a pub.
Mr. Jarvie.
Thank you, Your Worship. In a number of the zones that we are recommending for the liquor manufacturing be permitted would also allow for public houses. So restaurants. So many of the zones are consistent along those lines. Perhaps the biggest area of discrepancy would be in some of the industrial areas where we don't specifically allow for the restaurants. But for the commercial zones and the service commercial zones, the same zones that would permit pubs would also permit the liquor manufacturers.
So anywhere we could see a food primary, because we do have them throughout the city, where restaurants that are serving, you know, alcohol and have TVs and everything. So because we allow food primaries in those areas, this would not be out of the neighborhood context then?
Correct. It could be a liquor primary, food primary, liquor manufacturing. They'd all be permitted in mostly the same zones.
Okay. Now, looking at the attachment that was handed out today, the municipal scan, which I thought was very interesting, under it says, looking at the other cities, and it says, do they permit liquor manufacturing? Just about all of them say yes in specific industrial zones. Do they mean yes in industrial zones, or do they mean just specific industrial zones? Because we've sort of done some consolidating. We're not being specific, because we're saying in any of these zones. So I'm just wondering, how are they more restrictive in these cities just because of how we've now done our zoning?
To be honest, I can't speak definitively on what some of the other municipalities' zonings permit or don't permit, or why certain ones would permit it where others wouldn't. But traditionally, a lot of these liquor manufacturers have located within industrial areas, and that was where many of them got their starts. Some of them are along some major commercial streets, as we're many of us in the room are aware that in Port Moody, what they're referring to now as their brewery district, is in a highly public, high traffic location. So different municipalities have approached it differently, and then the breweries are locating along some of these nodes in there. And from the city's perspective, we've taken a broad approach to what zones we would have permitted in. And then, as I alluded to a few minutes ago, many of the zones would be similar to what our liquor primary and food primary are already permitted in.
I think the Port Moody model works well. I guess it just sort of self-created. One moved in, the others moved in next to it. There didn't seem to be, there wasn't a comprehensive zoning or anything that was done to permit it. It looks like it just sort of evolved there, and I think it's worked quite well. But I'm just curious, because when I look at our scan here, the municipal scans, it says, do they permit liquor manufacturing? I'm going to assume that when we said liquor manufacturing, you meant / lounge, because as we're finding out tonight, there seems to be quite a difference between just manufacturing and actually having the lounge and operating more like the pub. So it is hard from the sheet. I appreciate the sheet's very helpful, but if I go on that assumption, then it's most of the other municipalities are letting them pretty much go anywhere within the zone.
Yeah, like I said, many of the municipalities do allow for the manufacturing. Many of them do have the lounge endorsements. Port Moody is our nearest example. They've opted out of the referral process, and their three are indeed lounge endorsements. Right now in the city, we currently do technically permit liquor manufacturing in our industrial zone as a manufacturing use. However, there'd be no tasting room or accessory retail associated with it. So, many of the municipalities are looking at it differently and allowing it in a different range of zones.
There's a couple say, like Langley says, yes, approved as permitted use in a comprehensive development zone. So you could sort of say sort of Millardville or, the new Fraser Mills, and we could do a comprehensive zone and say within this area, this is the area, and that way you would create that district.
We could go that route. Many municipalities use CD zones as their staple, and each new major project goes under CD zoning, whereas in the city of Coquitlam, we have more broad general zone, which are a little more all-encompassing, a little less restrictive than going through the CD zone route. Fraser Mills is the one and only CD zone we currently have in the city, and I think that that's a unique example of a project, and it warranted a zoning regulation for CD type zoning. Could look at a CD zone, but I think our zoning, is broad enough and it's all encompassing that it would cover this use.
Certainly it's broad enough, but if we change the bylaw to allow it, once we do that, a business who takes out a license and complies can operate in any one of these locations. They don't come to us and say, we want to open up at such and such a corner. If that property is zoned and we approve these in that zone, they would come forward and it would just be a transaction at the counter. They would not come to us unless they wanted to change their permit from a lounge and then to a lounge, and then we would comment on it. So if we open this up to as a general bylaw, then any one of these locations in these zones, somebody could set up there.
Yes, Your Worship, that is essentially what's been recommended. I guess what And the broader thinking behind that was to enable a variety of options for these types of businesses to become established. I do recognize that in the municipal scan, you know, permit liquor manufacturing, that's one operation, but does it also, under that zoning, permit the a lounge endorsement? Knowing a number of these municipalities, they're pretty tight on that too, so it may not be as apparent as you might think. The thing I'd point out about the city of Langley and this in the CD zoning, city of Langley is not much bigger than Coquitlam Center. No, that's a little bit of a slight. It's a very small area, and they have, you know, very focused planning and zoning control over that area. So the CD is their, as Chris has said, they're probably their more common tool.
So they, some could be more restrictive than others. It's hard to tell.
Okay, yeah. I got to do this. I've let this go on quite some distance. This is a public hearing. We're going to have to let hear from the public a little bit, and I wonder if we could get council to hold off on their questions related to the specifics of zoning, and I do want to get to as many of these folks as possible, and I kind of want to let Mr. Hick eventually sit down. This isn't a standing committee, but I've got two others I've got Councillor Zerillo. Any questions for Mr. Hick?
I don't have any question for Mr. Hick. I have a question for staff, so I can wait if you prefer.
Oh, either one.
Mine was about municipal property tax implications, because I've started to think now differently about this craft brewery as more of a lounge, and so I wanted to understand what's the difference between light industrial taxes that maybe liquor manufacturing would pay versus if it was a pub or a liquor primary or a food primary. So that was my question, and we can keep it till after if you like, but I would like to understand the property tax implications.
Okay. Very good. Mm-hmm. We'll hold that one. Staff will have a really good answer when they get to that one. Our next speaker is Jeff Wiganard. Oh, well, just like it's spelled.
It's rhymes with vineyard, which is helpful for my industry.
Vineyard.
I have to be honest, I've used that joke before.
Yes.
Thank you, Your Worship, councillors. My name is Jeff Kinyard. I am the executive director of an organization called BC's Alliance of Beverage Licensees, or ABLE BC. Basically, we are advocates for the private liquor industry. We represent about 350 private liquor stores and about 600 pubs. I care about both sides of this equation this evening. Basically, if you want a nutshell, I agree with pretty much everything Bert said. The longer I work in this industry, the more I realize that's usually a good place to stand. And as an organization, we're quite supportive of staff support to council. I've been traveling around the province a little bit as other municipalities are grappling with the implications of the ever-changing liquor landscape in British Columbia. And I think Coquitlam has done a tremendous job of trying to strike some balance and to get to the nuances of how that's going to affect your communities. So overall, quite supportive. And I think that other communities will look at this, as another speaker said, as kind of some leadership out there, because they are sort of looking for this sort of analysis. There are gaps in provincial policies. To go to your point earlier, Your Worship, is there a role for municipalities here? There definitely is a key role to play. Provincial policies are often a very broad framework, and it's up to you to determine how you want that to be managed in your community. And you do have the ability to have more stringent restrictions on use than that are in existing policies. Ultimately, I won't take up too much time. I just want to talk about a few things. But ultimately, from our perspective, this is about fairness in the business environment. If you look at something like the 1 kilometer distance separation, private liquor stores have been abiding by that rule for, I can't remember how many years now, but just many years. And on April 1st, it was expanded to include government liquor stores. So it only makes sense from our organization, if there are any other new retailers, grocery stores, et cetera, coming into the market, that they should be abiding by the same existing criteria. And the reason we feel that way is it's a regulated industry. It's because we're selling, you know, ciders and wines, not apples and grapes. And when you're in a regulated industry, the rules become a piece of your business model. So when you go to a bank, they look at your existing regulatory framework, and they look at your business plan for 10 years, and they make decisions based on that. So that fairness is crucially important for our members. And that brings me, I guess, to the lounges. It's a good discussion. I'm sure council will help me talk about the lounge endorsements more. But our concern, a lot of our members sell a boatload of craft beer. I mean, British Columbians clearly love craft beer, both as a packaged product in private liquor stores as well as in the pub side. One of the members of the John B., they have 60-some-odd taps, and about 50 of them are craft beers. So we're moving a lot of that product, and we're going to continue to do so. Our concern, though, is because things evolve over time, craft breweries have started off, you know, sampling products, and they have a little retail component in many of them as well. They sell packages of their own, or they'll sell growlers, and that's all fine. That's in the existing framework. Our challenge is when they start to expand that and become the full lounge without going through the same regulatory process that other liquor primaries have to do. So that is our only caveat on that in my broad support for craft breweries. We just want everyone to be buying by the same policy framework, which, if I read your recommendations, staff has recommended there be similar business license restrictions for liquor manufacturers with lounge endorsements and liquor primary establishments. So I think that's the intention of staff's efforts here, and I think you will find broad support for that across the industry. I also wanted to mention there was a 20% that was going around for a lounge endorsement. I just want to clarify that it's not on the retail side. It is only for product consumed at the brewery. So if you're in a lounge or a brewery's lounge, they're allowed to serve up to 20% of other products that are not produced there. So it could be another brewery, a winery, a cider, a spirit. And that's where you can see how it starts to become, well, what is the difference between a liquor primary and this lounge? You'd be starting to steal a full suite of products on there. And 20%, there are 37 liquor inspectors in the province. I'm not sure how they're going to be going around every single craft brewery all the time while they're also looking at 2,000 pubs and 7,000 restaurants to try and find out if you've abided by your 20% restriction. So in any case, I want to thank you. I think you're respecting your existing businesses in your community while also encouraging new competition and trying to modernize it. So that's great for us. And these are really just about fair, consistent policies that can help your business have stability. Because all these changes in the liquor policy industry really have created a bit of instability. And I mean, if anyone has owned a business before, you know, that is one of the most destructive things for you. So on that, I will end unless there's questions. Thank you very much for your good report, and I wish you well.
Thank you. Councillor Wilson.
Councillor Wilson, sorry, there you are, sir.
Everybody forgets about me. we talk about a 1 kilometer separation distance between liquor retail outlets.
Yes.
Do you have a similar expectation for a craft brewery that has a lounge endorsement in terms of separation between that and an existing pub?
Yeah, it's interesting. One of our members and I were just chatting about that. It's not something we have asked for so far. Although about 20 years ago, there were like a dozen craft breweries in the province, and now there are about 100 and 110, something like that. So it's something that we will look at. But I think what's more important than a specific distance requirement is looking at, as Bert said, treating them as though they are full liquor primaries. There's no distance separation provincially between liquor primaries. It may make sense for Coquitlam. I think some municipalities have tackled that challenge by having a very specific zoning and saying you can only be in certain industrial areas, so that way that they call it the craft beerification of an area, right? You end up with 4 or 5 breweries in a particular area and supporting that local neighborhood as opposed to impacting the other existing businesses. So it depends on how you want to handle it.
And so I've heard different philosophies or concerns or beliefs. Some say that having a craft brewery with a lounge endorsement right near a pub is damaging for the pub. Some say it's very good business for the pub. What is Abel's position on that?
I would say that if the craft brewery has a lounge endorsement and it has not had to go through an additional process with a public hearing or the additional licensing requirements of an LP, it is direct competition. I don't think there's, I want to be clear about that. I don't think there's any way they could not consider it competition. I think that if they don't have a lounge endorsement, it's just a tasting room, then it's really supportive to the local pub because they can probably say, taste this product, we'll sell you kegs, we'll sell you a package, or you can go to the liquor primary across the street and get our products on tap. Right? So they depends on which model they do. But the lounge endorsement, because there's a bit of a gap in the regulations right now, I think is a direct competition to an LP. I think it's the same thing in practice.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you very much, sir. You're welcome. Thank you, Councillor.
Okay. Councillor Zerillo.
Sorry, I just have another question now about opening times. So we have information about if there is a liquor manufacturer with lounge endorsement, there's some information about when it must open and close, but I didn't see any information about if it's just liquor manufacturing, which is doing tastings, are they allowed to taste till 11 p.m. at night? Like, I don't see those open and close times on here, so that would be another question as we talk about a fair and level playing field. Thank you.
Okay. I'll go to the floor now. Are there any other speakers to this item? This is where you put your hand up, or you stand up, or you come forward. We'll start with the woman. Oh, nope, she's... No, you're... It's a very polite audience.
Good evening, Council. My name is Anita Carter, and I'm from the Frog and Nightgown in Coquitlam. We are very, very aware of the local breweries. Obviously, we're right on that Port Moody border. All night, we've been talking about sampling and tasting. I really want to stress upon you the fact that you can walk in and you can see somebody with a full 18-ounce pint. There's not a lot of sampling or testing about it. So, yeah, you know, you certainly can still have two samples, but in the case of Port Moody, I don't know if it's such a good idea. It's off of the public transport, and you have three businesses that are operating as pubs that have a liquor food truck come by to sustain their patrons' appetite. I would just really please sort of look at that policy, and certainly, you know, if it's going to be a craft brewery, then the provision being that they can take growlers, etc., as soon as they want to actually offer their product to be tasted to a consumer, be it 2 ounces or 18 ounces, I believe that they should be mandated to have the lounge license and the same as the picnic area, etc. And I certainly appreciate both of Councillor Zirillo's and Reid's concern over that, because I think you're opening the door to circumnavigate, it's a pub. I think that's about it. Thank you.
Thank you. Now, sir.
Good evening. Thank you very much for having me here this evening. My name is Mark Hicken. I'm a lawyer that does quite a lot of work for the wine industry in British Columbia. I'm here to basically support what Mr. Hicks said about when I think the municipality looks at changing regulations with respect to the sale of wine in grocery stores. I'd like to address the issue particularly of the wine on shelves model. And I'd like to sort of back up what Mr. Hicks said in terms of, I think council should probably treat that as a model that is going to expand, and I have some legal reasons that I'd like to explain to you why I think that that is likely. And you've heard a few speakers mention possible trade challenges to the wine on grocery stores model, and I'm going to talk a little bit about that. The relevant trade agreements that might apply to challenge that model are GATT, NAFTA, and CETA, which is the Canada-European Trade Agreement. The latter agreement, the Canada-European Agreement, has not actually been ratified, so it's not really relevant. The two really relevant agreements are GATT, which is 128 signatory countries, and NAFTA, which is the USA, Canada, and Mexico. Both of those trade agreements have a principle in them which requires that Canada treat products from other countries with no less favorable treatment and the quality of competitive conditions. So imported wines and domestic wine are supposed to be treated the same. In GATT, there are no exemptions at all. So GATT just requires Canada to treat all imported wine the same as domestic wine in terms of market access. NAFTA basically has the same requirements in it, although there's a limited exemption. So that if there was a private wine store that existed on October 4th, 1987, that provided preferential treatment for BC wine, that preferential treatment can continue. But it's critically important that the store existed on October 4th, 1987, otherwise the exemption doesn't apply. And sometimes it's bandied around that there's a permissible number of BC-only private stores in the province. That is not correct. There's no permissible number of private stores in the province that can retail BC wine only. And I think this is important, too, because the BC wine industry has enjoyed really excellent government support and some preferential treatment over the years, which has contributed to its incredible industry success. But there are some trade compliance issues with that support that's been provided. And one of those trade compliance issues is the existing BQA store licenses. As I mentioned, for those licenses to get the exemption under NAFTA, they have to have existed on October 4th, 1987. And in fact, most of the BQA stores in the province, the 21 licenses that are commonly referred to, they did not exist on October 4th, 1987. The vast majority of them did not exist on that date. So they are vulnerable to a trade challenge on that ground alone. Another piece of important information is that the BC wine industry is allowed to what's called direct deliver products throughout the province. And if it uses that direct delivery system, which means they can send wine directly to a customer, a consumer in a house, or to a licensee, like a restaurant, hotel, or bar, there's no liquor board markup applied. So that's a very significant advantage for the BC wine industry. But to date, right away, there's some trade compliance issues there. To date, there have been no trade challenges on those issues. And I think the main reason for that has been that the retail advantage, those freestanding BQA stores, most of our trade partners have not been too worried about that because they're in sort of fairly low volume stores located in tourist areas or neighborhoods. But I think the regular store, the shelf, regular wine on shelves model is very different. The supermarket channel is actually, as one of the speakers mentioned earlier, supermarket channel is one of the is the dominant retail channel for distribution of wine in the world. And in jurisdictions which have grocery store wine sales, about 65 to 70% of all retail wine sales occur in grocery stores. So I think it's my opinion that the government has actually created a system which is vulnerable to trade challenge. I think it's very likely that there will be a trade challenge. One of my clients, the BC Private Liquor Store Association, commissioned a very comprehensive legal opinion from a fellow named Cliff Sosnow, who's with Fasken Martineau in Ottawa. He's one of Canada's leading international trade lawyers. And that is an extremely comprehensive trade opinion. It categorically concludes that the regular wine on shelves model is a violation of both NAFTA and GATT. So it's my view that there's no doubt that there will be a significant trade compliance problem, and there probably will be a challenge, I think. Australia, Chile, the EU, and the USA have already lodged complaints with the province, and there could be challenges from any of those countries. It's also possible that a challenge could be launched by an aggrieved player within the industry. For example, Ernest and Julio Gallo, which is the leading winery in the United States, could decide that they want to finance a challenge because they want access to supermarkets in British Columbia. And you know, one of the things that I've mentioned a few times to people is I'm not aware of any jurisdiction in the world that has successfully limited the sale of local wines to supermarkets. And the reason for that, I think, is fairly simple. It's just not permissible under international trade agreements. So I think that, you know, I think it's quite likely that there will be a challenge. If a challenge is launched, it will include a challenge to the existing VQA store licenses, and it will likely also include a challenge to the direct delivery system, which provides huge benefits to BC wineries. And in fact, I'm aware that work is actually proceeding right now on those trade agreement challenges. So I think that this is something that council should be aware of, because I think that what will likely happen is a challenge will be launched. Industry will have very little control. It will become part of wider trade negotiations. And probably the eventual resolution will be that all the supermarket licenses will open up to all product. And if craft beer was allowed into supermarkets, I think the same thing would happen. It would blow wide open eventually, and all beers would be sold in supermarkets. And in fact, one of the gentlemen earlier on mentioned the situation in Ontario. Ontario's approach to supermarket wine sales has been quite different. They're going to only allow Ontario preferences for 3 years, then they're going to phase it out completely. And I think that was a rather canny move on the part of Ontario, because 3 years is probably about the length of time that a trade challenge would take to occur. So if a country was thinking about making a trade challenge, you'd probably say, well, it's probably not really worth it if the preferences are going to expire in 3 years. And I think probably similar sort of things can happen in BC, within about 3 years or so, those supermarkets will be selling all wines. So I think from a municipal perspective, I think it's very important for councils like yourselves to consider that and to realize that while this may seem like an attractive model that will help small BC producers in the short term, in the long term, it probably will turn into a wide open alcohol sales model in supermarkets. Those are my comments, and I'd be happy to answer any questions if you have any.
I thank you for that. You're suggesting that we not consider putting BQA on the shelf.
Well, I'm just trying to provide some perspective. I think that, that I think that, you know, if you're thinking about it, don't think that it's going to be just BC wise.
I got it. Well, I actually appreciate your expertise, Councillor Rasmussen.
Well, thank you very much. And just, I guess, the public hearing tonight is to relate to the items that aren't here, and we're not in our item here tonight. We're not talking about wine on the shelves in stores. We're talking a liquor store within a grocery store, a separate unit, so that wouldn't be part of our regulations. I'm just trying to get us down today to stick to the item that's here.
I'm speaking in support of your recommendation that you monitor that model and do not rush into that.
Yeah, but I'm just saying we're not going that way. Yes. We're not proposing to go
that
way.
I support that.
Yeah. And for the VAQs, if there is a challenge and something, that's something that we as the province and all places, because if we lose a challenge and liquor becomes available in all grocers, we can't stop. That means even our council here then can't make those changes either. But for
yes, absolutely. That's correct.
Yeah. So for tonight, you support?
I support the recommendations.
The recommendations moving forward that we have here. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Are there any other speakers to this item? Come forward.
Good evening, Your Worship, Council, staff. So I would just like to come up and talk a little bit from the perspective of someone who is hoping to eventually
I could get you. That's me in the middle.
I'm looking around. I'm a little nearsighted, so I can't really see anybody
else. Your name and address for the record.
All right, Kirsten Reese, 550 Cottonwood Avenue.
Thank you. Go ahead.
All right, so as somebody who is hoping to eventually be opening a craft brew, a craft brewery, not a brew pub, as seems to come up pretty often tonight. I'd like to talk about a couple of the points that seem to keep coming up from our perspective. Lounges and tasting rooms are very key to the modern brewery's business plan. As things are going, craft beer, the more of it you get, the more specific people are in their tastes. People are looking for different experiences, they're looking for a huge amount of variety, and the brewers are looking for a large amount of control over their products. With beer, you do have to be fairly delicate with it if you're not going to be filtering it or processing it in other ways. And oftentimes when you have nothing but production on site, with no sales on site, you lose control over your product, how it's treated, what temperatures it's stored at, who is going to be pouring it, how they pour it. You lose large amounts of your flavor and thus your name as a brewer, if you're giving your beer over specifically to other people to sell for you. Care is often taken, but it is hard to keep track of things like, for example, if you are selling to a liquor store. You can go into a liquor store and buy bottled beers. If they've sat under UV light, that alters the flavor, it alters the quality. Often they get a really nasty, skunky flavor, and people will not buy your beer. I'd also like to note that especially the tasting rooms, and if you can get one, a lounge license, provides a good amount of profit margin for your brewery. It can take you from subsiding to actually doing well and being able to expand. When it comes to the lounges and the tasting rooms, the ones that I've been in, and I am an avid craft brew fan, so I have been quite a number, they do take care to monitor their patrons, monitor things like the noise, because nobody wants to end up with a bad reputation as a craft brewery. The community is fairly active and fairly vocal. Word gets around if your place is not a nice place to go. As a consumer of craft beer, I don't particularly enjoy going to a normal pub. They tend to be very loud. There isn't really anyone you can talk to about the beers. Most of the time, you don't get anybody who's very knowledgeable about the beers. There's those annoying loud TVs everywhere, and the music is too loud for the most part. I really prefer the experience of a lounge room. for me, that is one of the big draws. And if you severely limit that, you're going to severely limit the number of people you draw into the city, the number of brewers who'd want to be here, because now they have to work with so many other regulations, and there are other places we can go. The more open you can leave that, working hopefully one with by one with these people, the better off it'll probably be for everybody. I would also like to know that within the locations you guys are opening up, you may want to consider that not all of those locations are going to be applicable for craft brewers anyway. There are some specific things that you have to keep in mind. You need good water quality treatment. You have to be able to process your water. You can't just dump your wastes into the sewer directly, not typically permitted. So there will already be limitations on that. We're not going to be able to pick off any site that you've set up there. So most likely places closest to residences, unless they already have wastewater treatment within them, they're not going to work very well for us at all. And lastly, I'd also like to note that for craft breweries, the ones that we've seen and talked to, both here and in Portland, separating us out is going to be harmful to those people, the craft brewers, to the patrons, as it causes them to have to jump around. Many people who are looking to buy craft beer are looking, once again, for variety. If they have to drive to a number of places, that is discouraging and unenjoyable for the most part. And they will perhaps park themselves in pub, but most likely they're just going to go home. So those were the main points I wanted to cover. I wasn't planning on speaking tonight, so I think I've done well.
Okay. Questions? Someone who didn't plan to speak tonight, you did well. Councillor Hodge.
Very good. And you answered a lot of my questions, but I do have one. You mentioned again, that's, as one of the earlier speakers mentioned, that it does work better as a group.
Yes.
Without giving away your business plan or anything, but is this something that, as somebody who's looking to set up one of these, would you be looking for other partners or people, or would you intentionally try to find a spot, or is it a case of whoever sets up one first, the second person to get a license starts looking in the neighborhood? I'm just sort of wondering, the Port Moody one sort of came and it works. I'm just sort of wondering, from a city land planning, how do we achieve something like that where we get a cluster together?
Well, that would be probably having an area where it's permissible and fairly easy to get the brewery. Right now, the biggest trouble is finding an area that's close enough for people to be able to get to, that also has some sort of wastewater facilities that's also being permitted by the municipality. Some of them are opening up, making it more permissible. And then if we can find an area with other people, we'd prefer that. If we have to take an area out in the middle of nowhere, we may choose to wait or go to another municipality. Right. Location is especially key.
And some of the feedback that I've heard as a councillor is, they're going to end up with one up on the top of the plateau or somewhere. And that doesn't sound that that fits your business model. It sounds like you want to be in a transit area or where you can cluster, as
if
opposed
possible
to being a one-off.
Yeah, that's one of the things we actually find funny, is how often the idea of parking comes up when it comes to places that are serving primarily alcoholic beverages. If we can get to a transit line, I personally prefer taking transit to be able to go to craft breweries if I can, because then I don't have to worry about anything. You don't have to have the poor designated driver who doesn't get to enjoy the delicious beer. If you get lucky, you know someone who doesn't care very much for it and is perfectly happy to drink some water, but then you have to actively find that person. Having it in your transit is definitely a bonus. But for the most part, people interested in craft beer are not interested in dying on the way home and will plan appropriately if they have to.
Good. Thank you for your presentation.
Any other questions?
And we've got Councillor Wilson on the other side.
You'd mentioned not all areas are able to process the wastewater. I'm not familiar with the process there, so is that something that a craft brewery can install on site, or is that something that has to be provided?
You can install it on site. However, it is very expensive to do. So if you're looking to get the startup money for a craft brewery, that ends up in, I think, I'm fairly certain it's over $1 million to put in, on top of whatever else you need for your fermenters and staffing costs and setting up your lounge room or your tasting room or whatever it is you have. So it's a significant expense if you are just starting a craft brewery, because typically you're not coming into this with, $30 million. You might be looking to maybe get three.
So my question to somebody on our staff, are most of the areas that we're proposing served by some sort of wastewater treatment or the proper process required for these kinds of businesses?
Do they have large enough buildings?
Your Worship, if I could, and
Mr. McIntyre.
I was just conferring with my colleague, Joseph Azeghi, General Manager, Engineering, Public Works, and I'll refer it to him in just a moment for the more detailed perspective. This question had come up as part of the public feedback, the general public feedback about, on one hand, the consumption of water for the processing, but also then equally, with the byproduct and waste flow. And so we had done some initial checking on that, and our understanding at the planning level is that it'd be subject to Metro Vancouver permits because it qualifies as a certain size of operation, but they still need to meet certain levels in terms of the amount and quality of the discharge. Now, our understanding was that can be done through that Metro process. How that exactly would bear out and any implications for the city's sanitary sewer system, perhaps Joseph could speak to that.
Mr. Diozeghi.
Your Worship, indeed, the Greater Vancouver Sewer Region Drainage District just enacted a bylaw last year. It's called Fermentation Operations Bylaw Number 294, and as I said, it was enacted in 2015. Essentially, what the bylaw says that from fermentation operations that produce waste that when discharged or discarded into the regular sewer system, it may obstruct the flow, interfere with the operation and performance of sewer and sewage facilities. Therefore, a different treatment is required. In other words, the discharge cannot be just simply put into the sewer system.
So each craft brewery would need some sort of treatment process before it's discharged into our sewers.
Well, the bylaw doesn't tell the operator how they need to treat the discharge, but they set the criteria what can be versus what cannot be discharged. So there are obviously options. One option is that the discharge can be processed on site before the allowable part can be discharged into the standard sewer system. Alternatively, they have to find a different operator who would basically put it in a tanker tank and take it to a place where they can clean it, process it.
And so if there was a cluster of three or four craft breweries, would it maybe be feasible then for them to share a processing?
I really don't have an appreciation for the volume of the discharge, so I can't answer the question.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. None others. Thank you very much. Next, anybody else? There's one over here, I believe. Yep, there he is. No, oh, he's hurt himself. Oh, okay.
Good evening, Your Honor, Councillors. My name is Matthew Killick, a resident of New Westminster. My address is 320 Royal Avenue. Together with Kirsten, may not be family, but part of the craft brew family. Just want to say a few words about a few topics that we heard about tonight. I will try and be as brief as possible, so hopefully we don't need to use the timer here. We talked about regulations and trying to ensure that you can foster growth in industry without being overregulated. So I wanted to talk about that. Just as in any industry, we would want to work within the regulations. We want to work with the municipalities. I want to say that sorry, I got a bit of a throat thing going on here. I want to say that we have approached a number of different municipalities, each at different levels of maturity within their regulations. Now it's
was with great energy and enthusiasm we received the news that Coquitlam was looking at doing this change. But we want to say that it is a 6 to 9 to 12 month process to put this together in terms of putting a brewery from an idea on paper to actually implementing it. So these are not things that are going to happen tomorrow. Sorry, Mr. Ray, probably not going to happen this summer because it is something that does take time. These are significant investments. The infrastructure to develop these projects is $1 to $2 million of just hardware and equipment that comes into the facility, not to mention leasing, not to mention staffing, not to mention testing and development of recipes and things like that. So it is quite an investment, and the people who are doing this are quite serious. So this is something that Coquitlam has a great opportunity to be a part of. I would urge you to regulate it as best as you can, but I would also urge to not over-regulate it. We heard about CD zoning and things like this. This is an industry that is built on creating a community and creating a good energy. This is something that happens naturally with a little bit of course, regulation, whether or not you call that natural or not. These are things that happen spontaneously and grow, not because they're said or told to grow there, but because there's a reason. And that reason might be the first brewery starting up. It might be on a transit line. It might be something like that, but it's definitely not a council or a city or a municipality or anyone saying that you have to be here or there. The lounge aspect, to briefly touch on that, is a very important piece. Kirsten mentioned it's a very important piece of the business case. But it's also the biggest part of being a community. The lounge is where people gather. The lounge is where people talk. The lounge is where business happens. The lounge is where what this is really about. This is about creating a community. I'm not sure that necessarily that's needs a picnic area or not, obviously we would welcome that. But certainly from a lounge perspective, this is a really important piece of the overall business case, not just looking at from a revenue or a margin perspective. But the whole business is driven by creating a community, and I think that's what we're here to talk about today. From a 20% perspective on the lounge for selling other alcohol, that's an important piece of this. This is something that allows not only beer friendly folks to partake in this community. Typically in today's day, beers are hoppy, they're technically strong flavored. There's a lot of variety, but there's also a lot of strong flavors that people may not like. This is where the 20% comes in. This is allowing for wine, potentially, distilled spirits of other varieties, meads, honey wines, which are delicious, and if you've never tried one, I suggest you do. These are things that allow more people to participate in this industry and become more, to really grow it. That's all I can say. Location, location, location. I think the wastewater treatment part is key, just to touch on that. The main things that you have to deal with are the ingredients of beer, which are hops, barley, and yeast, obviously in water. So those are organic things. There is a opportunity to filter out as much of that as possible to deal with the wastewater. So there are ways to deal with that. And obviously you fall into regulations that need to take care of that. So that's all I have for right now. And I didn't plan to speak, so I'm glad I only took 5 minutes.
Got a question here.
Good. Ended with 2 seconds left.
Yeah.
Councillor O'Neill.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Killick. How would a craft brewery with a lounge license control that 20%? At some magic moment on the 28th of the month, somebody orders a glass of wine because with a group of beer drinkers, but this person is a beer drinker. Would you go and, oh, no, you can't have the wine. We just reached our limit. And how would you do that?
That's a good question. Usually you have a big red alarm bell on the wall.
Really?
But if you don't have that, I think the
I think, you know, I not to make little of the 20%, but the real goal of any craft brewery and the margins are in the product that you're selling and making. As with any other regulated industry, you do have to report how much you make and how much you sell by the barcode. So there is monitoring. There is it may not be watched very like a hawk by the 37 inspectors in the province, but it is there and technically it's documented.
So it could be like 2 or 3 months after somebody's going through the paperwork that you have to file and went, oh, they sold 22% that month. We're going to have to talk to them and maybe fine them or shut them down for a day or something like that.
It certainly could happen like that.
Okay, thank you.
Councillor Zerillo.
I want to thank you for coming out. This is so interesting and actually quite a technical discussion, and I really appreciate how open you've been on this. My question is relates to the idea of organic growth, how these things kind of just blossom somewhere and expand. Where in Coquitlam are you looking right now? Is there any area you're thinking this would be cool, this would be appropriate?
Can I plead the Fifth Amendment?
No, I need to know.
Okay, yes.
They're saying that it's a competitive advantage, maybe not to say where or there, but I guess I'm just trying to understand, like, we've got a big number of zones here, and it would be nice to be able to...
Based on the map, it is, it's not like this is going to be a free-for-all. This isn't going to be, this isn't going to be in people's living room, I don't think. This is going to be in areas where there's high traffic, near to public transportation. So there's areas like Burnett, just off the highway, places like that that already have light industrial areas. But also commercial areas, places around new developments that are close to new developments, but not necessarily in, from a from a volume of people perspective, right? You want to be close to the people. As Kirsten mentioned, this isn't a lot of people. This isn't a car community. This is a bike, walk, transit community. Obviously, there are people with cars, and you have to adjust for that. But there's a big market out there that doesn't drive cars. You want to be close to the people you're serving.
Thank you so much.
Anybody else?
Anybody else?
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Please.
I won't be too long because I didn't plan on speaking either. But my name is Brenda Arstead, and I live at 712 Gilton Street in Coquitlam. And I'm in support of craft brewery. And I just want to say I'm really excited, as being a resident of Coquitlam, that we are actually thinking about doing something like this, because we have a great little community here. We have a lot of people coming into our community, and I think we need craft brewery. They're a great little thing to get together with friends. And I went June 15, 2015 last year, went to Portland and rode my bike with a few friends all over Portland. We had a great time. We don't want it up Westwood Hill. That's way too much of a bike climb. But anywhere near transit or a nice flat area for riding your bike is a great place. And I really am excited to hear that Coquitlam is looking at doing something like that, and that we could maybe get in on board for the six-month thing this summer. Probably not, but just, you know, wishful thinking maybe. Thanks.
Hello, I'm Kendall Payne from Port Moody, right on the border of Coquitlam, so I consider myself kind of a citizen of both.
You have 10 seconds.
Love the... love... thank you. Love the idea of the craft brewery, and just wanted to give you some insight. I've gone down to the one in Port Moody, and one day I was pedaling my bike down there, and I went down. It was great, and I went in for a couple of beers, and to speak to what Anita said from... a frog in a nightgown. I had two, three 18-ounce pints, and before I knew it, I'd locked my bike and I was walking home. So I love it. I think the craft breweries, remember something, it's about tourism too, and bringing people and saying that you have one, but you really have to regulate the lounges and make sure that they go through those due process. If not, prime example, I've been there, it was like being in a pub. And I think one thing regarding craft breweries, too, remember a fad sometimes, too. Everyone likes a growler now, but have you ever carried a growler around for a long time? After going three times to for example, Moody Ales, I love the Moody Ales product. It's a great product, but I'm not bringing the growler down there anymore. We have enough facilities in Coquitlam now where I can go and get, I can go to my local establishment and I can go to my local retailer and I can get my Moody Ale now. So after being down there one or two times, I can go get it from somewhere else. So great for tourism, and I want to put forward the Richard Stewart Pale Ale, and I think that would be a good one, and Burke Mountain Lager.
Take as long as you like, sir.
That'll be good. Thank you very much.
He's getting you on side.
In the interest of balance, I want to point out that your mayor, Mike Clay, just posted on social media that he's opposed to Coquitlam having Mike Clay. Anybody else? Anybody else? Any other speakers to this item? Any other speakers to this item? The third and third and final time. Any other speakers to this item? Are we all through? I'll declare this item closed. I'll declare the public hearing closed. We're going to take a break while we reestablish tapes. It'll take about 10 minutes.